Hey, my name is Pastor Patrick. I'm a missionary in the Philippines, and I do online ministry. By the grace of the Creator, I've been able to help lots of people. And today, I just felt led in my heart to come on and talk to you guys who may see this video. I feel this video is going to be seen by the right people who are bound. And the Lord has put just a love in my heart for people who are bound, and particularly homosexuality, or drug use, alcoholism, any kind of addiction, pornography, any kind of addiction. There's people that have, you know, there's even people that have all kinds of things going on. Bestiality, you know, they have a desire, you know, to have relationship with an animal. There are people who are bound by the devil in those things. And, you know, we think about these things. I wanted to tell you this. You know, a lot of times we think about these things. And, of course, you know, we're all have our free will, as they say. You know, we have our own ability. So, but I just wanted to talk to you from what's in my heart from the Lord about this, the great love that the Lord has. Because, you know, we have a free will, brothers and sisters, to choose. But, you know, someone once said when I first started in the ministry, there was a lady gospel singer, and she used to always tell her testimony. And, you know, she had been an alcoholic before she got delivered. And she would say that, you go one step with the devil, and he'll take you places that you never wanted to go. He'll force you. He'll drag you to places you never want to go. And so what happens is that's why it's bondage. And, you know, people say, you know, just like in the Bible, the people said to Jesus, when Jesus said, you know, to whoever you serve, that's your master. So if you serve God, God is your master. You want to serve the devil's your master. You serve sin, evil, or wickedness, then that is your master. And then they said to him, oh, well, we've never had anybody to be our master. We're not slaves. And Jesus said, whatever you commit yourself to, that is your master. So, you know, a lot of times when you deal with people who are in denial, you know, for me, the only denial is a river in Egypt, okay, that turned to blood by the command of God through Moses and Aaron. But lots of people are in denial. They'll say, well, you know, I'm the captain of my own ship. You know, I have a brother that's an addict. And he'll always say, well, I'm in complete control of everything I do. Yeah, right. Yeah, right. Are you in complete control when you get in trouble with the law? Are you in complete control when you lose your job? Are you in complete control when it's like in the homosexual community, you have this, you know, especially homosexual men, you're having sex with all these different people. So even if you try to say that homosexuality is normal in the community of homosexuality, there's a huge amount of promiscuity. I mean, it's not like, you know, you hear about gay marriage where two men live in a monogamous relationship for 34 years. Most of the time, they're having sex with people in bathroom stalls, at rest stops, and all this kind of stuff. There's a huge amount of promiscuity. And so you can see, if you open your eyes and see, that it's a spirit of lust. It's not just an alternative form of love. So you may have some desire that was in your heart to be with a same-sex person, or the one in a billion that wants to be with an animal or whatever, or to do drugs, or to, you know, which is much more common, homosexuality, doing drugs, looking at pornography, all those things. But when you start it out, like people that look at pornography, you can ask anybody that looks at pornography, or even think about the lowest level addictive, people that, you know, that watch TV all the time, or eat chocolate all the time, you know, get overweight from being gluttonous, or smoking cigarettes, these, you know, lower level things compared to, you know, we're not going to, you know, I'm not getting into mincing which sins are which, but of course the Bible says that homosexuality is an abomination to God. Doing drugs, you're allowing spirits to enter your body. You're surrendering your soul to the devil, you know, whereas someone who's overeating, you know, they're slowly killing themselves, and so therefore, you know, are people that smoke cigarettes. You can ask anybody, people that smoke cigarettes as an example. If they could, most people would quit, but they have an addiction. They have a desire that is drawing them. Same thing with, you know, a lot of times the people that have an addiction to food, you know, and that's, like I said, this is just not, you can't, you're not, we're not equating that to be a drug addict or, you know, engaging in promiscuous, you know, sex outside of marriage, okay? Sex-aholic, sex addict. with multiple people, et cetera, et cetera. Any kind of sex outside the marriage between one man and one woman, especially people that are doing some excessive stuff, dangerous stuff, you know, having sex in public or you know, all the kinds of things that people do. When people are drawn to do these risky behaviors, self-destructive behaviors, you know, it starts out when you had that free will choice to smoke that first cigarette, to smoke that first marijuana joint. You know, then the next thing you know, you're strung out on heroin or whatever happens to people. You know, alcoholics, homosexual, they say, well, I'm attracted to men. But as I said, if you were in a monogamous relationship and got married and lived with the same person for 40 years, of course, homosexuality is still a sin. Sodomy is a sin, but and an abomination to God. But most people who are doing that, there's no quenching of the thirst. You know, so when Jesus talked about demons, he said, when you cast out a demon, Jesus said, that it goes into the dry land. And this is also confirmed in the book of Enoch, which used to be in the Bible and they took it out, but it's not important. But Jesus said that when a demon is cast out of someone, it's ever thirsting, you know. It's in a dry and thirsty land and it's looking to be quenched. And then it said, then Jesus said that demon goes back to the same person. Now, if that person didn't become a Christian and they're not filled with the Spirit of God, and they're still lost person, they're still an independent captain of their own ship out here being their own man, which like I mentioned, I have a brother that's a drug addict. And, you know, he's his own boss, right? Yeah, right. You know, no man is an island unto himself. You know, he still has yokes upon him. A yoke, for those of you who don't know, it's like, it's a thing you put around the neck of a horse and you hook a horse up to a team or oxen like they used to do. You can use a cow sometimes too. You can hook it up and plow a field with it, you know. And that thing around their neck is a yoke. So all of us are beasts of burdens, you know. We all have, we're you know, let me say this to those of you who are non-believers. I mean, no one is, as I said, is an independent agent. You can't go out here. You couldn't survive 1 second without the atmosphere that God created. You couldn't survive 1 second without, you know, your heart beating that God gave you, the breath of life that God put in each of us, that life force. When someone dies, if you go look at a dead body, you can see it's like a shell. You can see it's like there's something missing. That's that spark of life, their spirit that God gave them. You know, our body is just a shell. And then the real us is our spirit. And then, of course, we have our mind, what people call the mind, our soul, the part of us that says, yeah, let's go party, let's get drunk, let's go have sex with that, you know, let's look at porn, let's have sex with this as many people as we can, you know, whatever, all those different things. That's our soul, our mind, that we call it, our earthly, fleshly self. And then we have our spirit man. So there's three parts. Every person, like God, is the Father, Son, Holy Ghost. We have spirit, soul, and body. It says clearly in the Bible, in the New Testament, it says, you know, God bless your spirit, soul, and body. So we have those three parts of us. So our spirit man is the one that we want to be led by. So I'm going to do some, like, a little better, more teaching on it, but I just want to say this. Whatever you feed, this is just like a lowest level of self-deliverance, okay? And I'm going to pray for you guys to be set free today. But I'm teaching about it instead of really preaching, like proclaiming it so loudly, just talking to you one-on-one. So you can be set free with the Lord and you don't need anybody to help you. Of course, the Lord is the one to set you free. But the first thing you have to do is say, you know, if you feed your desires, then it wants more and more and more. It becomes ravenous. There's no quenching. I want to tell you this as an example. You could go, let's just say you're just a regular guy, a man. You're not a homosexual. You're not on drugs or anything like that. You're just a regular guy. I mean, as far as that goes, you know, just in the normal range of what God would have us be. Okay, and then there's lots of men when they become 40, they do middle-aged crazy. Let's look at that as an example of a man, which is a common thing. Here's a 40-year-old man. He's married. He's got a family. He turns 40 as an example. Then he says, you know, some men say, I want to get a Corvette. I want to go get a Harley Davidson right across the country. Some men say, you know, I want to get me a 20-year-old mistress. You know, to get me a young woman to make me feel young and all this. And so this is a common thing that happens, too, in the world. And then the man goes and does that. And then, you know, he even maybe leaves his wife marry in America, and in some countries like the Philippines, there's no divorce. They'll just keep their mistress, and when she gets old, get a new one and keep a mistress all their life. Any Filipino, almost 100% Filipino man with any means of money to support that will do it because, well, the country's only 5% Christian, so. And it's a kind of a tradition in this Hispanic countries, Hispanic colony countries. But anyway, so in America, people get divorced. So they will go get a young mistress, divorce their wife, and then they got this young mistress. And then what that man will find out is he'll see another girl and say, yeah, I want to get that girl. I want to get this girl. So what the man, if he has any sense, and he's a backslider Christian as an example, he'll realize that it's not that woman. It's that unquenchable lust, just like with heroin. In America, they say, you know, there's a major epidemic with heroin all over the United States. The main reason why we do need to control the borders to stop the flow of drugs. As an example, heroin and all that by the millions of people, whatever. You see the pictures of the husband and wife passed out in the front of a vehicle on the side of the road, kids in the back seat, in car seats. There's the parents like zombies passed out from drugs. I've seen the news several times in the last couple of years. It's a never-ending lust. And that's where you get into the spiritual part, brothers and sisters. So, or my friends, if you're not a Christian, to be a Christian is brothers and sisters. You know, to become a brother and sister of Christians is to be a Christian. That's what makes us brothers and sisters. We have the same Father. So for God to be your Father, you have to be a born-again Christian. Don't believe the story that people tell you that, oh, you know, we're all God's children. No, we're all God's creation. But the Bible says that when we're born into sin, and we're strangers and enemies of God. And there's an enmity there's a great gulf between us and God. And the only thing that unites that and connects that is, of course, the cross of Christ. Now, most people who's watching this, who's an English speaker, you've heard the gospel before, but you didn't listen to it. You heard it, but you didn't receive it. You didn't hear it, or you just didn't care. But Jesus said, those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. The way for you to get out of those chains is to give your heart and soul and mind and everything you've got to God. Surrender all to the living God. And the way to get across that great rift of your sin, your mistakes, your all the things you've done wrong, to get across that Grand Canyon of your guilt, your sin, your stains of bad things, is to cross upon the cross of Christ. And that's the only way. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can go to God but by me. Jesus is the only way. Now, I know lots of people on there, you know, who might see this, and I've talked to tons and tons of agnostics and atheists and everybody else. I used to be a volunteer chaplain at a homeless shelter for men, drug addicts, all kinds of stuff. People, grown men, 50-year-old men sniffing paint and all kinds of self-destructive, demonic oppression and chains and bondage. And they know the truth, but they don't, you know, they just don't want to repent. Listen, aren't you sick? Aren't you sick and tired of being sick and tired? Aren't you tired of being a stooge? You know, that's why I tell people all the time about whatever their addiction is. I mean, you know, you claim you're so prideful about being independent and the captain of your own ship, but yet, Budweiser's got you on a little string like a little chump. You're a little stooge for Budweiser. You're a stooge for Jack Daniels. You're a stooge for Marlboro. You're a stooge, you know, for Krispy Kreme, if you're gluttonous on Krispy Kreme, you know, that's causing you to have high blood pressure and diabetes, which is, you know, to damage your body is a sin. But of course, the major things, heroin, you know, some kind of, you know, cocaine, whatever, all these things. There's a brother I prayed with to be delivered from cocaine down in South Carolina. Praise God. You know, it took, you know, marriage crisis to get him straightened out. But as far as I know, that he's still free. And God is the one to help him. God is the one that made a way for him. So, you know, the thing about it, and that's a whole other thing, but listen, there's destruction in your life from your addiction. Addictions, whether it be homosexuality, you know, drugs, whatever, it causes destruction in your life. Jesus said that the devil only comes for one reason, that's to kill, steal, and destroy you. John chapter 10, but Jesus said, I come but to give you life and life abundantly, life to the fullest. That's in this life and in the life to come. You know, a lot of times people preach, or you've heard preachers, and they're talking about, yeah, in the pie, in the sky by and by, you know, pie in the sky by and by. It's not only about, oh, when you die, you're going to heaven. You know, that's why when they asked, when Moses was talking to God at the burning bush, most people have heard that story. Moses asked God, well, what should I, you know, who shall I say you are? Well, I tell the people of Israel, who are you that sent me? You know, God, who? What does that mean? And God said, tell them that I am that I am. Not I was that I was, or I'm going to be that I'm going to be. I am that I am. God is with us in the now. Jesus said that many times. Jesus, the Son of God, said, I am the bread of life. Those who eat this bread will never die. If you eat the bread, the crucified body of Christ, you will never die. Jesus saying you receive in your spirit what Jesus did for us on the cross, you'll never die. He said, I'm the light of the world. This world is full of darkness, heroin, you know, homosexual, you know, sex that people are having in, you know, in the bathroom at the mall or a rest stop and all that. Self-destructive, lustful behavior that's killing people, giving them AIDS and hepatitis and, you know, and then just ruining their, you know, you if you're doing all that, like I said, you can't even have a, you know, God intends for us to have a monogamous relationship and walk in a family, you know, to have a family and have stability and a home life and all that. When you're running wild and having all this synonymous sex, I mean, there's no love. There's no love in that. And for men, and nowadays even women who are running around, you know, like these college students, just, you know, they think they're supposed to get, their parents are paying for them to go there and get liquored up and have sex with all these different people and all this and learn all this communist manifesto of the universities, making them into wicked monsters. There's no love in that. That's all destruction. I ask you to open your eyes. Humble yourself. See, the thing that kills people always, that sends people to hell, brothers and sisters, and separates people from God, is pride. Pride goes before a fall, the Bible says. You probably heard that. A haughty spirit before destruction. Haughtiness is like, you know, walking around, you know, looking up at your, you know, with your nose in the air. You know, oh, I don't need God. Yeah, I got on my, yeah, I'm captain of my own shit. I'm the man, you know, I'm got my own boat here. I'm doing my own thing. You know, tune in, turn on and drop out. I'm doing my own thing. You know, there's something called the Satanic Bible, you know, and it goes all the way back to Sir Francis Bacon, at least Sir Francis Bacon. But it's famously accredited to a guy named Aleister Crowley. It's known as the most wickedest man that ever lived. That's what they called him. And he wrote, you know, a manifesto of this fallen angel that talked to him. And what he said is, you know, we have the Ten Commandments in the Bible. The devil gave him one commandment, and that one commandment is, do what you want to do. Do your own thing. Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. So the devil's law is do what you want to do. Do your own will. And so I say to you, those of you who are burdened and heavy laden, are you getting tired of doing your own will? As a matter of fact, isn't the devil dragging you, kicking and screaming, into the fiery furnace? Isn't he dragging you down into the pit? Isn't he destroying you through drugs, through alcohol, through homosexuality, through promiscuous, wild sex addictions with whatever, whomever, whenever, all the different things that people do, pornography, etc.? Aren't you tired of that? Aren't you, you should be, you don't even have enough sense to know it now. But God is so gracious and merciful. God doesn't have to do anything for us. You know, the Bible even says that in Genesis 6, God will not always continue to strive with people. And, you know, today is, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. You know, when you hear the truth, like you're hearing right now, harden not your heart. Don't let your heart get hard against God. Because today is the day of salvation. God may never ask you again. Just like my sister-in-laws, you know, they were in a wreck yesterday. And thanks God they lived and they're recovering. They had concussions, but by the grace of God, they're better today. We've been praying for them and they're 50% better today. They're on their way to recovery, but they could have been killed. They could have been killed. One of my sister-in-law is not a Christian. And I told them, you could have been killed. See, you're just like Jesus told the parable of a man who said, well, you know, I've got all this abundance. My barns are full. I'm so rich. I'm a great big rich farmer. I'm going to sit back and chill out. And Jesus said, thou fool, don't you know your life is required of you this night? This very night, your life can be required of you. You could be killed in a car wreck tonight. You could, you know, you could be hit by a bolt of lightning. You know, the rapture could happen. You'd be left behind. You could fall over dead. Someone could just shoot you or a drug overdose or whatever. You don't know. No man or woman is guaranteed the next breath. God doesn't have to do anything for us. But He chose. He chose the famous verse that almost every person in the world knows, that Jesus spoke, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, and what an only Son, those who believe in Him would not perish but have everlasting life." God did something for you while you were still a sinner, which you are today, if you're not walking with the Lord. He died for you. And it says that God demonstrated His love for us. God showed His love. Love is an action. God showed His love while we were yet sinners. He sent His Son to die for you and me. As they say, when Jesus was on the cross, we were on His mind. When Jesus took those stripes, it was for me and you. He didn't do anything. He lived a sinless life. He took my sin, your sin, upon Himself. He suffered for us. I want to read some verses to you real quick. I just want to read two verses to you, three verses. From Matthew chapter 11, starting at verse 28. Jesus is talking. He said, "Come unto me, all ye that are labored and are heavy laden." That's a load on your back, carrying a heavy load. "And I will give you rest. Take my yoke." I told you about a yoke, what that is. "Upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. And ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." As I said, there are people out there, and I know those people like my brother. There's lots of people like that, nobody's got me yoked. Oh yeah, your sin has got you yoked. Whether it's pornography, alcohol, whatever it is. Even over, gluttonous eating and gaining weight and having high blood pressure and diabetes and all those things. You've got yokes on you. And Jesus said, "Those whom the Son sets free are free indeed." When Jesus sets you free, you're free. He breaks all those chains and bondages. So that's why I want to invite you right now. This is your day. This is your hour. This is your moment. This is your moment to be set free, to receive Jesus Christ, to have eternal life in heaven with the living God, not to be sent, and separated. It says, you're cast into outer darkness. You're separated. Jesus will say one of two things to people when they die. This is the truth. "I'm sorry, I don't make the rules. If it was up to me, of course, I wouldn't want anybody to go to hell. But I mean, it's up to the Lord. He's the one that made this thing. It doesn't matter if you believe it or not, or you like it or not. This is the deal." God didn't say, "Let's make a deal." He said, "This is the deal." And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." And the Lord Jesus Christ, and what does he say? He has two different things that He says to people. He either says, "Depart from me, I never knew you, you sinner, you worker of iniquities, sin, or enter into your rest, my good and faithful servant." So to enter in heaven, you must be a good and faithful servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. You must be a follower. The Lord Jesus Christ told people all the time, "Follow me. Take up your cross and follow me. Follow me. Follow Jesus." "I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back." Hallelujah. I invite you to call upon the name of the Lord. The Bible says all who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. I invite you right now. You pray in your own words. You understand the gospel. That Jesus, came in the form of a man, born of a virgin. He lived a sinless life. He was persecuted and killed, beaten and crucified for our sins. He died on the cross in our place. He took upon Himself our sicknesses and our diseases, our sin. He became sin for us. Hallelujah. He took it upon Himself. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Just like God told Adam and Eve, when you eat that fruit, you're going to die. And everyone since that day has been under that curse because of Adam and Eve. That's true. It's called original sin. We're born in original sin, brothers and sisters. But God has made that way for the Lord Jesus Christ. He took upon Himself our sin on the cross. And 3 days later, He rose again, just as He said. He's alive from the dead. Hallelujah. with glory forever. Just like he said he would rise from the dead with glory and honor forever. Hallelujah. He's seated at the right hand of God. Hallelujah. He's a high priest over us, making intercession for us. He's there. And so we will also be resurrected, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. That's when you hear people talk about the rapture. It's the Latin word for caught up from the Bible. Well, those of us who are alive and remain at the time of the beginning, before the tribulation begins, the seven-year tribulation with the mark of the beast, 666 and all that stuff. Everybody knows about 666, the mark of the beast. Before that beast, the Antichrist, comes to world power, makes a new world order, the Lord is going to catch up. Or rapture is the Latin word from the text in the Bible, says to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Hallelujah. So the Lord is going to rapture his church, and then after the 7 years, we'll return to earth with him, those of us who are caught up. Hallelujah. You want to be a part of that. You know, we're living in the end times. Look what all is going on in the world. It's time to be sober, to be vigilant, the Bible says. You know, don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. The Bible says to be sober and be vigilant, for your adversary, you know, our enemy, the devil, is like a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. Don't let the devil continue to devour you. Be free. Be free in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Be free by the grace of God. God is extending his grace to you that he won't extend forever. Hallelujah. When that, after the rapture happens, boom, just like the flood. God said, I'm not going to keep striving with these people. And boom, sudden destruction came. Same thing's going to happen. Very near future. And as I said, even that aside, you could be killed in a car wreck tomorrow. You don't know. No man knows what God holds your life in his hand. Hallelujah. God alone has authority over your life and my life. It's in his good pleasure that we live and breathe and have our being. I invite you right now in your own words, but I'm going to pray a prayer. You can pray with me, but you need to speak it from your heart, not like a robot. There's a lot of people do sinner's prayer, and then they don't even know what they're saying. They don't even mean it. No, speak from your heart to the Lord. Pray with me right now. Oh, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Lord, I know you died on the cross. I know you rose again the third day. I know you are my judge. Save me, Lord Jesus, from my sin, from my self-destruction. Save me, Lord, from my own wicked ways. Lord, you said in your word in the 23rd Psalm that you would lead us into paths of righteousness for your own name's sake. Lord, I know you're the good shepherd. Shepherd me, Lord. I'm your sheep. I surrender, and I'm going to stop being a wolf or a snake, and I want to be one of your sheep, Lord Jesus. I want to be one of your sheep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I want to be one of your sheep, Lord God. Not a wolf or a snake or a bad person anymore. I want to lay my burdens at the foot of the cross. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving me. I receive salvation today by the blood of Jesus Christ that covers and washes away my sin. Hallelujah. 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 There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me. Hallelujah. With his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Listen, you want to email me? My email is under every video, neartochrist@aol.com. You can email me. I'm available to minister to you, to pray with you. The Lord has already set you free. If you have any doubts, you need any extra prayer to get free from those addictions in your life. I hear from people every day about drugs, alcohol, homosexuality is one of the biggest ones, pornography, etc. You got to get clean. You got to get free. You can't ride the fence. You can't be lukewarm. You can't keep climbing around with God. Don't play with God. As Jesus said, I would rather have you to be hot or cold. Don't try to be lukewarm. But the Lord said, if you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you out of my mouth. Choose this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the living God, as Joshua told the children of Israel. You have to choose. You can't ride the fence. God don't play with fence riders. The tribulation is for fence riders. The tribulation is for the lost, the wicked, the fence riders. Don't be a part of any of those groups. Hallelujah. Don't be a part of any of those groups. Be part of the J team, the Jesus team. Be a follower of Jesus Christ. Be on the Lord's side. Hallelujah. Choose this day whom you shall serve. Hallelujah. How long will you keep climbing around in between, as Joshua said? Pick a side today. You'll be forced to. During the tribulation, take the mark, which means pick the side of the devil, or we're going to chop your head off. Don't matter if you're a follower of Jesus or a Buddhist or a Hindu, whatever you want to be. You take the mark or we're going to chop your head off. So you have to not take the mark and become a Christian and get your head chopped off. That's after the tribulation starts. Today is the day. It's never going to be any easier. It's never been in the history of this creation. There's never been an easier deal. Other than that, well, of course, Adam and Eve had one law, you know, don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But since the fall of man, there's never been a deal like what the Israelites had to go through with the law and all that, sacrificing animals and all that. We don't do none of that stuff, brothers and sisters. Praise God. Praise God. We're in the New Testament. That's why it's called a New Covenant, the New Testament written in the blood of Christ, a new covenant. It's not the same covenant. It's a new covenant that God made with whomsoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. Praise God, I'm a whosoever. Hallelujah. You don't have to be born in Israel. You don't have to be Jewish. You don't have to be one drop of Jewish blood. Hallelujah. You could be the son of Charles Manson and get born again. Hallelujah. Even Charles Manson, Adolf Hitler, if he was alive, he could repent and become born again. What mercy and grace has our God extended. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before Him. Heaven and earth adore Him. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. God bless, brothers and sisters. I've got to run. You're going to be doing some traveling. I'll be in Australia by the end of the week. God bless you all. The next video, by the grace of God, will be from Australia. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you all, brothers and sisters.